Thank you, Dr. Kapoor, for the introduction, and thanks to everybody at SGPGI for having me here. I'm really going to touch on very up-to-the-minute news. There were some vaccines that made a lot of progress over the last couple of days. So what I'm going to talk to you about really builds on what Amita has just told us about where we are with the vaccines and the kinds of vaccines we have. So we heard about the mRNA vaccines, and there are two mRNA vaccines that are currently in wide use. The data from both of these vaccines became available in November of 2020. And one of the reasons that it became available so quickly was because they were funded very heavily by, in Moderna's case, by Operation Warp Speed. And Pfizer had made a decision to go ahead with going into phase three studies very early on. So these, usually, why does it take a long time to develop a vaccine? It takes a long time to develop a vaccine because of the process that Amita told you about, but also because the risk of failure is high. And whenever you are in human clinical trials, that is a very expensive high risk of failure. So what usually happens is once you get into humans, you'll do a phase one study, you look for safety, it will be in a small number of participants. You'll get that data, you'll present it to the regulator, you'll write a protocol for the phase two. The regulator will approve it. So there are lots of gaps between phases. What's happened in this situation is that not only have there been no gaps, there's also been some overlap or combination of phases. Either phase one and two have been combined or phase two and three have been combined. In the case of the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine, BioNTech is a small company that was focused on cancer immunotherapy, working with mRNA, and they decided to make a switch to infectious disease vaccines about 5 years ago. And they had started to work on a MERS coronavirus vaccine, as well as on using the mRNA platform to make multiple vaccine candidates with funding from the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations. So when the sequence of SARS-CoV-2 was released a little over a year ago, BioNTech was asked whether it would make new vaccines, and they agreed to switch their program to SARS-CoV-2. And about 6 weeks later, were in talks with Pfizer, and that led to the Pfizer-BioNTech partnership that has resulted in the first licensed product, which is an mRNA vaccine. It has shown approximately 95% efficacy. This includes efficacy in older individuals. The problem with this vaccine is that it needs storage, long-term storage at minus 70 degrees, which makes this vaccine a challenge to deliver at scale, particularly in low and middle income countries. On the exploded map there, you can see which countries the Pfizer vaccine is licensed in. In green is countries where it has full licensure. In yellow is countries where it has emergency use authorization. It's also been given an emergency use listing by the WHO. So this is the vaccine with which we have the most experience, which is all of about 6 weeks since the rollout started. But millions of doses of this vaccine have been given. The Moderna vaccine, developed by a US company, is similar. It has 95% efficacy. Its storage requirements are less stringent, still requires minus 20 degrees. And this has also been approved by multiple regulatory agencies and given an emergency use listing by the WHO. Now, with Pfizer BioNTech, if we look at the FDA's analysis, you can see here the data for 7 days after dose two, so 5 weeks after you start the immunization program, you have about 95% efficacy. And as Amita showed in her slides, there's also efficacy. There's a good level of protection that occurs even after the first dose of the vaccine. Now, the other aspect of what we look at in addition to safety, in addition to immunogenicity and efficacy, is safety. And there are always safety concerns with new vaccines or with untested platforms. So in the trials, which included about 45,000 people and for whom about 38,000 people's safety data was evaluated, there were 4 cases of Bell's palsy in the vaccinated and 0 cases in the people who had received the placebo. Now, there were no cases of anaphylaxis that were seen in the trial. But subsequent to the vaccine being rolled out, at least initially, it looked like anaphylaxis was being seen at a rate of about 1 in 90,000 people initially, but it seems now that the rate is something like 1 in 150,000. And this is happening mostly in people who have a history of anaphylaxis before or have a history of very severe allergies. Just allergies to occasional allergies to food, to medicines, don't seem to be playing a role in predicting this. So this also speaks to the importance of having a really robust safety monitoring mechanism once vaccines are rolled out, because Bell's palsy looked like it might be a signal in the clinical trial. It doesn't so far seem to be one in the rollout. Anaphylaxis was not seen in the clinical trial, but is now being seen when the vaccines are being more widely used. Now for Moderna also, if we look at the protection in all participants, it's about 94%. And if you look here at 65 and older, this is giving about 86% protection. Moderna's results are looking good. Moderna's vaccine is also being rolled out in Northern America and in Europe. Now, with Moderna, the safety signal seems to be somewhat less than is seen with the Pfizer vaccine. There is anaphylaxis that is seen with Moderna, but this seems to be in the order of 1 per 500,000 vaccinated individuals. So about 3 times lower risk than is seen with the Pfizer vaccine. Again, these are early days, and we will need to continue the safety monitoring to understand really how these vaccines perform. Now, if we look at vectored vaccines, how do vectored vaccines work? I think there's one thing that is important to understand is that when you have some kinds of vectors, what you're looking for from the immune response is not only antibody mediated effects, but also T cell effects. So if I can explain that, this is a representation of the Gamaleya vaccine, which is a slightly more complicated vaccine because it has 2 different adenoviruses that are given to people. The adenovirus shown in blue and pink here with the spikes carries the sequence for the spike protein of the SARS coronavirus type 2. This is taken up into vacuoles in the host cell. Within the vacuole, the penton spikes of the adenovirus come off And the adenovirus delivers the message for the SARS-CoV-2 spike to the nucleus of the cell. From the nucleus, the double-stranded RNA, double-stranded DNA is then converted to single-stranded DNA, is read by mRNA, and mRNA leaves the nucleus to deliver the message to the ribosomes about making the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein. It makes the cell makes the protein in the cytoplasm, and you need three molecules of the spike trimers to combine together to make the spike. On the surface of the cell that has been infected by the vector, you see both the entire spike protein as well as portions of the spike protein being displayed. When this happens, what you get is both an antibody response as well as a cellular response that results in the destruction of the cell that is viewed by the body as being an infected cell. Now, among the adenovirus vector-based vaccines, I'm sorry, my slide seems to have shifted a bit. The ones that are front and center are the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, also Covishield, which we are getting. And this is a vaccine that is given as two doses, 4 weeks apart. And depending on how you look at which arm of the study, it has somewhere between 60 and 90% efficacy. It has received an EUA in the UK, restricted use approval in India, and yesterday was given full approval in the EU. There is a discussion ongoing about why Germany decided that the vaccine was not to be used in over 65-year-olds, but that is because the data from the study are not yet complete, and it's anticipated that when more data become available, there will be information to support that decision, support a revision of that decision. We also got data from the Janssen vaccine, and this is a recombinant adenovirus vector, which is AD26, and this is a vector that has been used previously for an Ebola vaccine, and this shows 66% efficacy. The Gamaleya Institute vaccine has been reported to have 92% efficacy, and this uses two different adenoviruses, AD26 and AD5. CanSino uses an AD5 vector, and this is a study for which data are not widely available in the public domain. Their phase one data was published in The Lancet and showed that if you had prior exposure to adenovirus, it resulted in a somewhat lower immune response. Now, I'd just like to walk us through some of the Covishield results. Shown in the map is where the serum Covishield AstraZeneca vaccines have been approved so far. And what I'd like us to focus on first is table 2C. This is the AstraZeneca efficacy, and this is for the standard dose and two doses of the standard dose. Now here you can see that if the vaccine is given at a dose interval of less than 6 weeks, efficacy is about 50%. And if the dose interval is greater than 12 weeks, efficacy is about 79%. Now, why does this happen? There's a lot of discussion about what is the immune response induced by the first dose, and what is the immune response induced by the second dose, and why that dosing interval really matters. But if we look at the recommended schedule in India, that is 4 weeks apart. Now, the other thing that I would like you to look at is the comparison of Covishield and the Oxford vaccine made by AstraZeneca. And these are the data from the Indian participants, where you can see that Covishield is comparable to the results that are produced by the Oxford vaccine. You could argue that Covishield is actually a little bit better in terms of an immune response. However, since we don't have a correlate of protection, we don't actually know whether just the measurement of antibodies, whether they are IgG that is directed against the spike or neutralizing antibody, really correlates with the clinical performance of the vaccine. It's hoped that we will be able to develop an immune correlate of protection, but we don't have one at this time. Now, we got the results from the Janssen phase 3 study, and this was from almost 44,000 participants and over 400 cases. And what it showed was that the vaccine was 66% effective in preventing moderate to severe COVID-19 4 weeks after vaccination. Now, the Janssen study was interesting because the study was done in South Africa as well. And in South Africa, as we know, in the last couple of months, we have had circulation of a variant that is concerning in terms of its ability to escape the immune response. So if you look at effectiveness seen in efficacy seen in the study, it was 72% in the US and 57% in South Africa. The Gamaleya Sputnik vaccine is in phase 2-3 studies in India. They've completed the phase first 100 and they are recruiting for the next 1500. So the size of the study is similar to what has been done for Covishield. And based on 78 cases, Gamaleya has reported 92% efficacy and said that it is greater than 90% in people over 60 years of age. Gamaleya is also trying out two interesting studies. One is called Sputnik Light, which will be a single dose vaccination, and also doing a combination with the AstraZeneca vaccine and Ad26 from the Gamaleya vaccine. Now, in terms of inactivated vaccines, we have pretty far along and in wide use. Three vaccines from Sinopharm, from Sinovac, and from Bharat Biotech. The Sinopharm product uses alum as an adjuvant, and this has been reported to have 86% efficacy from UAE and 79% from China. Sinovac has been tested also in multiple locations. This was reported to have 50% efficacy in Brazil, but this is with the inclusion of mild cases, and you usually expect better protection against severe cases. It's about 65% in Indonesia and 90% was reported from Turkey, but this was on the basis of a relatively small study. In India, we have restricted use in the clinical trial mode of Bharat Biotech. This is a vaccine that is based on an inactivation of a strain isolated by the National Institute of Virology. And this has a unique adjuvant that has not been tested in humans before. It's made by a company called ViroVax in the US. So this is now being rolled out. They have finished their phase 1 and 2 studies in almost 800 participants. It has really good immunogenicity and it shows a good T cell response. They've also done animal challenge studies that show good results. They finished recruitment for their phase 3 trial, which is almost 26,000 participants, and follow-up is ongoing. Now, we also got results from the Novavax trial, and Novavax was the first of a new class of a different class of vaccines. This is a protein vaccine. And Novavax makes its vaccines using a baculovirus vector that is then grown in insect cells, and those insect cells produce the protein, the spike protein of SARS-CoV-2. That is then purified and adjuvant is added, and that makes the Novavax vaccine. The vaccine has been evaluated in 15,000 people in Britain, and based on 62 cases, of which only 6 occurred in vaccinees, it's been calculated to have 90% protection, 96% against the older coronavirus, and 86% against the new variant, or what's called the UK variant. In South Africa, they had about 4,400 participants, and here the vaccine showed much less efficacy, about 50%, a higher efficacy in those who were not HIV exposed and lower in the ones who were HIV infected. And most of the infections here were from, well, about at least half, if not more, of the infections were because of the South African variant of concern, which is known as B1.351. So there's a lot that we've learned in the last month, month and a half about vaccines and their performance. There are many other vaccines that are on their way in phase 3 studies. CureVac has an mRNA vaccine. Angus, which is a Japanese company, and Zydus Cadila have DNA vaccines. There's a vaccine called EpiVac Corona, which is a protein vaccine made in China. There's also an Anhui vaccine, and I'm sorry, that's a receptor binding domain and adjuvant vaccine, which is in phase 3. Medicago is making a vaccine in tobacco. And this, essentially, it gets tobacco plants to produce the vaccine. So ultimately, the vaccine will be a protein vaccine. And then Clover, which is also a Chinese company, is making a protein vaccine with adjuvants. So there's a lot that has happened, a lot that is going to happen, and there is a lot for all of us to learn about vaccines and their performance. Thank you.